Hello everybody, and welcome to session 4 of the Genomic Variant Analysis and Clinical Interpretation course. Today we'll be talking about interchanging variant nomenclature and syntax checking. Now we've already discussed HGVS nomenclature in great detail in the previous session. However, just to brush up, HGVS nomenclature is basically used to report and exchange information regarding the variants that we are analyzing. These variants could be DNA, RNA, or protein sequence variants. The main aim behind creating the HGVS nomenclature was so that it could serve as an international standard while reporting variants. This becomes particularly important in the case of applications such as DNA diagnostics, in which case we typically take a patient's sample, sequence it, and tell either the patient or the physician as to what clinically actionable variants a patient might have. Now we'll talk about the standard HGVS notation. We see that it can be divided into two halves by the means of a colon. The first half typically contains a reference sequence followed by its version, while the second half typically contains the type of the variant as well as the description of the variant. So in this case, if we look at our variant, it is an NMID, which means that it is an mRNA variant that we're talking about, followed by the version, which is 2. The type here is the coding type, and the description here basically involves the position of the variant, which is the 4375 nucleotide, as well as the description of what the nucleotide is, in this case, a C2T substitution. Now we talk about reference sequences in greater detail. Reference sequences are basically sequences that help us define the type of the variant. So they tell us what kind of a variant we're talking about. If we talk about DNA-based refseqs, we see that there are two main kinds of reference sequences that we use. The first is an NCID, which basically defines the variant in the terms of its chromosomal location. The second is an NGID, which defines the variant in terms of its gene or genomic location. Next, we have an NMID, which talks about mRNA or the coding RNA types, followed by the NPID, which basically talks about protein changes or amino acid changes. Now, a thing to note here is that for one particular gene, we would typically have a unique NC and a unique NGID. However, for the same gene, we will most likely have multiple NM and corresponding NPIDs. So if we look at the case of BRCA1, for example, we see that these are the unique NG and NCIDs. However, there are multiple NM and corresponding NPIDs, some of which I've shown here. Now, why is this the case? The reason is simple. It is due to the presence of multiple transcripts. We all know that DNA gets converted into RNA, which in turn gets converted into protein. It's known as the central dogma. Now, we know that DNA has multiple exons that are separated by intronic regions, and RNA inherits a similar structure. But what happens after RNA forms is that an event known as alternative splicing occurs, in which mRNA is formed by the removal of the introns and joining together of some or all of the exons. So for instance, here we see in the first transcript, we find all the exons joined together, whereas in the second and the third transcripts, we only see 3 exons, and that 2 different sets of exons joined together. Now, since these have a different sequence now with respect to the RNA sequence, we have allotted unique NMIDs to each of these mRNA sequences. Now, when these mRNA sequences get translated, we see 3 different proteins being formed, A, B, and C. However, these are similar proteins, similar to each other, since the sequence is more or less similar. Therefore, these are known as isoforms of each other. But since they are different from each other as well, we allot a unique NPID to each of them. So we basically see that one NMID would have a corresponding unique NPID. Now, when we're working with HGVS nomenclature, we see that there are several tools that exist that can help us make our workflow much more easier and smoother. What these tools typically do is that they either help us construct the HGVS notation in case we are not very familiar with it, or In case a paper already describes the HGVS notation, it helps us check the accuracy of it. Now, there are several examples of such tools. Today, we'll be talking about Mutualizer in great detail and also be touching about upon the Variant Validator tool. Now, what is the need for having such tools? There are several reasons for it. First of all, while we are reporting clinically relevant variants, it is extremely important that we be accurate when we talk about these variants. There are several diseases that already have mutation-specific therapies thanks to personalized medicine. So, for instance, in the case of several cancers, there are several therapies that are available that depend entirely on the kind of mutation the patient has. So in these cases, it becomes extremely important to identify the correct mutation in the patient and report it accurately. These tools help us achieve that accuracy perfectly. These tools help us promote uniformity in research. Now, if you look at papers, particularly the papers before the HGVS notation was actually standardized, we see that there is a lot of variation in the way in which the same variant is reported in different papers. Now, because of this, a lot of details sometimes often slip through the cracks. For instance, you will not probably know the location of the variant or what transcript was used or so on and so forth. So it becomes sometimes very confusing as to what variant is actually being talked about. So to remove all of those problems and to promote more and more uniformity so that it's easier to understand what variant is talked about, we use these tools that help us achieve that accuracy much better. Third, anybody who works with bioinformatics knows that good, well-annotated databases actually form the backbone of a lot of bioinformatics analysis. These databases are typically known as LSDBs or locus-specific databases. There are several examples of such LSDBs, for instance, ClinVar or LOVD, or IGIV's very own Dahlia and Mustard databases. Now, one important thing that we have to consider while annotating these databases is that we need to remove any and all redundancy present in these, which means that all the entries have to be unique, and therefore they can be annotated properly. Now, the only way to ensure that the accurate and only unique variants are present in the database is to attach unique IDs in the form of HGVS notation to them. And that can easily be done by the means of the batch functionality of some of these tools that help us convert large amounts of or large number of variants into the proper HGVS notation in a single go. Lastly, the HGVS nomenclature or guidelines themselves are always expanding so as to incorporate more and more details about the variant. Therefore, the only way to keep up to date with these variants is either to keep reading up on them or to use these tools that can help us report the variant in the current accurate nomenclature. Now, if we talk about the Mutualizer tool, this is what the Mutualizer tool website actually looks like. The tool is available at mutualizer.nl. Once you land on the homepage itself, you find several tools right on the homepage. This tool was developed by Wildermann et al. In 2008. And since then, it has become one of the most widely used tools regarding HGVS nomenclature. Now, what does the tool actually do for us? It will help us check the description of the sequence variants. It will also help us interconvert between HGVS terms. For instance, it will help us convert between an NM to, let's say, an NCID, or an NP to an NMID, and so forth. In case we're not very sure about how to report a variant, it also helps us generate these HGVS descriptions. Next, and very importantly, it brings together a lot of information from several different resources, such as Ensemble, UCSC Genome Browser, and several of the NCBI databases. And it also helps us interconvert between the formats of each of those. So you don't actually have to visit all of these websites to get information about your single variant. The tool will bring information from all of these sites right to one page for you. And it will also help you interconvert between the notations that each of these websites use. Now the tool typically takes input both in the form of GenBank as well as LRG formats. However, today we'll be talking primarily in terms of GenBank format. Just as an additional information, LSDB such as LOVD already use this tool extensively to check the descriptions that they post that then become available to the general public. Now, as I said before, each of these boxes are a single tool. They're all clickable interfaces. So if you click on, let's say, the SMP converter, it will take you to a page wherein you can convert your SMP into your HGVS nomenclature. All of these tools are broadly classified into three main categories. The first is the converter tools, which basically helps us interconvert between different kinds of HGVS nomenclature. The second is checker tools, which basically helps us check whether the syntax and whether the variant itself are correct. And third is a set of generator tools, which help us generate the variant descriptions in different input formats. Now, several of these tools can actually be utilized by batch jobs, which basically help us convert several variants or process several variants in the same go. Now let's look at each of these tools one by one. The first set of tools is the converter tools. The first converter tool is the position converter tool. Simply put, it will help us convert an NM ID into an NC ID and vice versa. So you can either input an NM or an NC ID and it will interconvert between the formats. The second is an SMP converter. Now, the DB SNP database, which is part of the NCBI, basically attaches unique RS IDs to each of the variants that it includes. Sometimes what a paper does is that instead of describing a variant in great detail or providing any HGVS notation for it, they simply take an RS ID of the variant and describe the variant throughout the paper by the means of the RS ID. If that is the case in your paper, you can simply copy this RSID into the SNP converter tool and it will give you all the relevant HGVS IDs associated with your RSID. So this would include the NC, NM, NP IDs and so forth. The third converter tool is the back translator, and as the name suggests, it will be it'll help you convert an NP ID back into the predicted NM ID. Coming next to the checker tools, we have the name checker. Now, it will take an input in the form of an HGVS nomenclature variant that you have, or a description that you've generated. However, it will generate a very detailed output for you to check. For instance, it will give you an overview of the raw variants in this format. It will give you a reference sequence in the 5-3 prime orientation, as well as a variant sequence in the same orientation. It will mark the ref and the alt variant here in between. So for instance, here the reference was a G nucleotide and it is being converted into a T nucleotide. Beneath this, it will also give you a link out to the UCSC Genome Browser website, wherein you can view this variant in greater detail. Apart from this, you will also get information about affected transcripts and proteins, and detailed description about the transcript that you've selected, the protein that will now be generated, the coding sequences, and the restriction sites that may be affected because of the presence of this protein. Now, all of this information and more can be downloaded by the means of a RefSeq file link that this tool also provides you with. So you simply click on the RefSeq and it'll download a file that will give you all of this information and it'll save it on your system. The next checker tool is a syntax checker tool. If you are new to HGVS notations, you can simply use this tool and it will tell you whether or not it is accurate, whether or not the syntax is accurate. In case there is an error, it will simply tell you what the error is by the means of a caret. This is known as the caret symbol. So the symbol will highlight where the error is, and the line below that will basically tell you what the error is. So you know where the error is, what the error is, so it becomes extremely simple for you to correct your nomenclature. Coming to the last set of tools known as the generator tools, as the name suggests, it helps you generate or construct your variant description. The first one is the name generator. It will help you create the description, and simply clicking on the description that it generates for you will automatically redirect you to the name checker page, wherein you will know whether the description that you have generated is actually a correct variant or not. And like we just saw, it will give you detailed information about that particular variant. The next is the description extractor tool. It is still an experimental service. It will basically generate your variant description by directly comparing the observed sequence or the sequence that you're working with, which contains the variant, with the reference sequence that does not contain the variant. And the last tool is the reference file loader tool. It will basically allow the user, that is you, to use your own reference file and to create a notation using your own reference file. Sometimes, there are variants or there are organisms or there are parts of the genome that don't really have reference sequences that are reported. In that case, you can provide your own reference file and it will help you. It will give you different options to help you generate a unique ID for it. Now let us look at how the Mutualizer suite of tools can actually help us with our workflow by the means of an example exercise. Now let us assume that you are a researcher who's working with the BRCA1 gene. While working, you come across this paper that talks about BRCA1 and 2 variants. You do a quick search through the paper and you find that this particular NMID is associated with the BRCA1 gene in this paper. Next, you find your variant of interest, which is a 5516 T2C variant, wherein a T is being substituted by a C at the 5516th position. This variant leads to this particular protein change in which a leucine is converted into a serine at the 1839th position. Now, using all of this information, you can easily create your own NMID simply by joining the RefSeq part with the C dot or the description part with a colon in between. You can also similarly create an NPID based on the information that is provided to you. Now, in general, it is considered a good practice to collect as much information about your variant as possible that has been reported in the paper before actually consulting any other tool downstream, such as the Mutualizer tool. So for instance, for this paper, for your variant, you know that your gene of interest is BRCA1. You've just created your NMID. However, if the paper had already reported NP or NCIDs, you should have collected those as well. You should check if an RSID is reported in the paper and also as to which build is being spoken about in the paper. For this exercise today, we'll be considering GRCH37 or the HG19 build. Now let us go to the Mutualizer website at mutualizer.nl and see what information we can gather using all of these IDs. Now these IDs are actually mentioned in the notes that have been provided to you. You can simply copy the IDs from there and work along with the video as it progresses. Now the Mutualizer website would be something like this. The first tool that we see here is the name checker tool. Now it is a good practice that once we have created an HGVS ID by joining the different components of it reported in a paper, to actually check the HGVS ID in the name checker tool before going ahead and consulting any other tool in the website. Now this is because sometimes the variant that is reported in the paper has some error in it, or it is not actually accurately reported, in which case the NMID or any other HGVS ID that you have created might be correct, but the variant in fact will not be. So even if you use that incorrect ID, Mutualizer might in fact give you an NCID or some other information related with the variant, but it will not be the accurate variant. Therefore, it is always advisable to check your variant using the name checker before going forth. So we paste our NMID here and we check the variant description. Now the tool tells us that there are zero errors and zero warnings, which means that this variant is an accurate variant. Along with this, it also gives you a host of other information about the variant. For instance, it will tell you it will give you the reference and the alternate sequence of the variant, and it will tell you that the ref is a T and alt is a C. Along with this, it will also give you a link out to the UCSC Genome Browser website, where you'll be able to visualize this variant in great detail and also gather other relevant information depending on the analysis that you have to perform. Now, because of this link, you don't have to separately go to the UCSC Genome Browser website and search for the variant. It becomes extremely easy by just clicking this link. Now, apart from this information, you will also get information about the exons, about both the genomic and the chromosomal start and stop sites of all the exons of the gene. Mutualizer will give you the description relative to the transcription start site. So you get an N.ID here. It will tell you about the affected transcripts, which is the transcript that we've just entered, 5516 T2C. It will tell you about the affected proteins. So here we see a leucine to serine conversion at 1839 position, which is exactly what we saw in the paper. So this further corroborates that our variant is actually correct. It will give you the sequence of the reference protein, that is the protein that would have formed in case the variant was not present. So in the sequence, we will also find a highlighted letter, which will show you where the change is likely to occur. Next, it will give you the sequence of the protein that is predicted to form because of the presence of the variant. And it as well will have a highlighted letter telling you what has changed. Apart from this, you will also get information on the effects that this variant might have on any restriction sites. Along with all of this, you also get coding sequence information variant where the start and stop sites are also mentioned. Now, all of this data can easily be downloaded on your system simply by clicking on this link here. This link is actually a .gb file or a .genbank file that contains all the information associated with this particular reference sequence present in the GenBank database, as well as all the information present on this page. So all you have to do is you click on this link and all that information gets downloaded onto your system very easily. So you don't have to separately go and consult the NCBI website. The data and all of this data will be downloaded on your system extremely easily. Now, in case you had just created your NM or NC ID and you just wanted to check whether the syntax is correct or not, especially initially when you're not very sure about the HGVS syntax and you don't really want any other further information about the variant, you can simply go to the syntax checker tool. Now, what this tool does is quite simply tell you whether your syntax, not the variant, but the syntax is correct or not. So you click on check syntax and it will simply tell you that in this case, the syntax of this variant description is absolutely fine. In case there had been an error, it would have highlighted the error with the means of a carrier and it would have told you what the error actually is. So now that we know that our variant is absolutely correct and that the syntax is correct as well, we are now interested in forming the NC or the chromosomal position of the variant in question. Now, what do we do to do that? We simply go to the position converter tool here. We click here. It will be redirected to this position converter page. The first thing we do on this page is check what the build is. Now, in this case, it is Homo sapiens, GRCH37 or HG19, which is exactly what we want. We're dealing with human variants and we're talking about this particular build. So we simply paste our variant here. Now, when we click on the convert variant description, we find our NC or the chromosomal variant ID over here. It will also give us information about the other transcripts that are present in this particular variant region. So for instance, in this region, you only have BRCA1 transcripts, and these are all the several NM and NR LRG IDs present on this in this particular region. Sometimes there's an overlap between two or more genes in the same variant region, in which case it will give you all of these IDs for each of these genes. So far, we've used the NMID that we had created from the paper to access the different tools that are present in the utilizer. However, what if the paper had only given us an NPID or spoken only about the protein change associated with the variant? In that case, we would have created an NPID, would have copied it, would have pasted it in the name checker to ensure that the variant was actually correct. And we would have simply gone to the DNA tools drop down here and accessed the back translator tool. Now, as we know, this tool will back translate our NPID and generate an NMID. This NMID talks about a 5516 T2C conversion, and we know that it is correct because this is exactly what the paper also spoke about. Similarly, if the paper had only given us an RSID, we would copy the RSID and we would have simply accessed the SNP converter tool here. Now, what the SNP converter does is that it accesses the DBSNP and gives us a list of all the AGVS IDs that are associated with this particular SNP in the DBSNP. So, for instance, for this particular RSID, we have one NCID for each genomic build, that is GRCH37 and 38. We have a unique NGID, and we have all the NM, NR, and NP IDs associated with this variant. So as you can see, we have our variant that we had been working with, the 5516 T2C, represented here as well. So in case an RSID is mentioned, you can very easily get an access to all the other IDs that are associated with your variant of interest. So this was all about the workflow which we follow in case a paper is talking about a variant in terms of an AGVS or an RSID. But sometimes that is not the case at all. Sometimes the paper just gives us a general description of the variant, or it talks about the variant in terms of sequences. So it'll give you a reference sequence and it'll give you an altered sequence. So what we do in that case is we come to the next set of tools, as we discussed, the generator tools. This is a set of three tools, namely the name generator, the description extractor, and the reference file loader. So how these tools can help us, starting with the name generator, is that, for instance, for this particular variant, if I don't know how to create an AGVS ID, what I do is I fetch the NMID from the paper. I tell the name generator that it is a coding DNA variant. I tell the tool that the gene of interest is BRCA1. However, this is optional. You don't have to include it here. Next, I tell it the kind of variant this is. This is a substitution. I tell it the position, which is 5516. And I also tell it that a T is being converted into a C. So it will give me the variant, you know, that is constructed based on all of my input. And it will give me it in a clickable form. So if I click on this variant, it will redirect me to the name checker, which will then tell me whether this variant is accurate or not. Next, we come to the variant description extractor. So like I mentioned, sometimes only a sequence is mentioned in the paper, particularly in the older papers. So what they do is they will just give you a reference sequence and tell you what has been altered in that sequence. Since our paper gave us a detailed description, so in this case, I've simply taken the examples that are mentioned here. I've taken the example reference sequence, pasted it in this box here. The sample sequence, basically the sequence that contains the variant of interest, we paste it in the box here. And we click to get this particular output, wherein the tool basically tells us what the sequences were and gives us a general description and overview of all the other information related to it. The next tool is the reference file loader. Sometimes when we are working with a novel part of the genome or a novel organism, or basically any variant that does not already have a reference sequence reported in either the RefSeq, GenBank, or LRG formats or databases, we can create our own reference file, and we can then tell the reference file loader tool how to access the file if it's stored on my system or there's a URL that it can take to access the file, and also which part of the file to access, whether it's a gene, particular gene, or it's the chromosome, or if it's a range. You can, there's a lot of options that you have that you can play around with. If it's a file, you can upload your file here. And once you do that, it will generate a RefSeq just for you, so that you can use that reference sequence to study your variant further. And that RefSeq will be a valid one throughout the Mutualizr tool. So any other tool, the entire suite of tools, so any tool within the Mutualizr tool will accept that particular generated RefSeq, and it will act as though it's an actual RefSeq and give you all the output accordingly. Now, sometimes all of these tools need to be used to process multiple variants in the same go. So, as we saw, each of these interfaces would only convert a single variant at a time. But if you have to process a large number of variants, you do so by the means of a batch job. What you have to do for this is you have to create an input file. So, basically, in this case, we have our three HGVS IDs. We take them and paste them in a text file. It could be, in the case of Windows, a Notepad. So, for instance, we can take all the NMIDs and paste it in one file, or all the NCIDs, or all the NPIDs, and so forth, depending on what tool we are going to use or what analysis we need to be done. And after we do this, we simply go to the Mutualizr website. We go to the batch checkers here. Now, the batch job interface will have all of these. Let's say we want to try a position converter. So we click on position converter here. So it asks us to check the assembly. Adding the email address is optional. In case you're in a hurry, you can just put this job and the results would be emailed to you. Login is not mandatory here. So this is entirely optional. Next, you simply click on choose file. It'll take your input file that you had just created. You simply click on submit batch job, and it'll redirect you to another page, wherein once your job is finished, a new link will be created, which you can simply click, and a text file will be downloaded to your system, which will contain all your results. Now, if we open this text file, we copy and paste it into, let's say, an Excel file. We see here the first column will contain our input that we had provided, namely the NM, NP, and NC ID that we had given it. The second column would talk about the errors that are associated with the IDs that we have provided. So if the ID is not correct, it will tell you exactly that the ID is not correct. Next, it will give you the NC ID for each of these. So this is the NC ID for your NM and NC IDs correspondingly. And then it will give you a list of all the coding variants. So all the NM, NR, LRG IDs that are associated with this particular variant will be obtained either by NM or the NC output. Now, as we know, Mutualizr does not give us an output. When we give a NP ID to the position converter tool, which is why this entire column, this entire row here is blank. Now, when we deal with these tools, typically we encounter errors. I've already discussed some errors with you, and it's fairly easy to solve these errors because the tool will tell you exactly what the error is and exactly where it is and how to solve it as well. However, I would like to discuss one particular example with you. This happens in the case of using the position converter tool. Sometimes what happens is when we enter a variant here, the tool will give us a output which says that this accession number was not found in the database. So either this accession number is incorrect, or this version number is incorrect. If the accession number is incorrect, that means that this is not a transcript. This transcript is not valid. However, if the version number is incorrect, then you can simply change the version number. That also the Mutualizr tool will tell you. It will tell you that the version 2 and version 3 for this variant are available, but not the version 5. So in this case, all you have to do is you change this 5 to a 3, and you change nothing else. Please make sure of that. So simply changing the version number will not make a very huge difference to your result. So all you do is you change this version number, let's say to a 3. And as we've seen so far, the tool has been working perfectly with the same variant with the version number 3 so far. So simply changing the version number will give you your results. Now, this was all about the Mutilizer tool. Coming next to the Variant Validator tool, this is the homepage of the Variant Validator tool, which is accessible at variantvalidator.org. In terms of functionality, this tool is more or less similar to Mutilizer. It will talk about validating your variant, so you can find out whether your description is correct or not. It also has a batch validator, so you can validate multiple variants in the same go. It will also give you, in case you enter your genes, so if you enter BRCA1, it will tell you, it will give you a list of all the NMIDs, all the transcripts that are associated with the BRCA1 gene. One new thing here is that you can also enter the file in the format of a VCF file. It will automatically take your VCF file, process it, and extract all your IDs or all your variants in the form of FGVS IDs and present them to you. One thing to note here is that this tool requires a login. So to try all of these tools, you would need to create an ID here and then access them. If you talk about advantages, the Variant Validator tool has two small advantages over the Mutilizer tool. The first one, as we just saw, is that it will take multiple input formats as shown here. So it will take HGVS just as the Mutilizer does, but it will also take VCF and HGVS-VCF hybrid format. So for instance, this would be a VCF format. Sometimes the colons are replaced by hyphens and so forth, mix and match of the format, but this is basically the format we're talking about. Papers rarely report variants in this format, but in case your paper does, you can always come to Variant Validator and utilize the same. Secondly, if you're working with intronic variants, Mutilizer sometimes has a bit of a trouble processing intronic variants. So if your work primarily involves processing a large number of intronic variants, you can always make use of the Variant Validator tool to process your variants. Now, this was all about today's session. Thank you so much for listening. If there are any doubts, please feel free to go ahead and ask them. Thanks a lot.